Hello everybody and welcome to another episode of that thing that we call One Credit Champ. The show that would be nowhere near as good if I was playing a fruit machine. So what are we playing today? God, I hope it's not a fruit machine. Fuck. Oh man, rampant ninja related crimes these days. White House is not the exception. Today's game is Bad Dudes vs. DragonNinja, so let's put the credit in. Let's press start, let's begin. Oh shite, the Awooga warning's gone off. President Ronnie has been kidnapped by the ninjas. Are you a bad enough dude to rescue Ronnie? I goddamn hope so. This is Bad Dudes vs. DragonNinja, otherwise just simply known as DragonNinja, made in 1988 by Data East. You play as one of the titular bad dudes, this chappy here, Blade, or as we're going to refer to him from now on, Johnny Whitepants, or the second player, Striker, who from now on will be referred to as Bobby Pierce-Pants. Their job? To rescue Ronald fucking Reagan from the evil clutches of the DragonNinja organization, a huge clan of multicolored ninja who all have a predisposition to running into old Johnny's feet, or knife, or nunchucks, or whatever the bloody hell he's carrying at the time. It takes the platformy elements of games such as Shinobi and Rolling Thunder and merges them with the proto beat 'em up mechanics of Kung Fu Master and is a neat little title, well loved and well remembered, if not for its gameplay, then for its ludicrous plot. So here we are already at the end of the first level, attempting to beat this boss who suspiciously looks like Karnoff. Why he's the bad guy in this, who knows? Maybe as a Russian, he agreed with the DragonNinja clan's anti-Reaganist stance. Can't say I blame him. Shouldn't be too hard to beat with old Mr. Stabby in my hand here. One more hit. There we go, he goes down like a sack of spuds. And I'm bad. I'm bad. I'm really, really bad. Stage one clear. Go to next stage. Well, go on then. Go to next stage. Whenever you're ready. Excellent. Now, what other interesting tidbits can I tell you about DragonNinja? Ah, yes. This title was ported to many, many home formats. All the stateside folk watching will probably recall the NES version, if they're going to recall anything fondly. Over here in the UK and Europe, though, because we didn't have a video game crash, and as such, the NES didn't gain anywhere near as much popularity, despite what some revisionist historians might say. We had home computer versions, courtesy of Imagine, who at that time had been bought by Ocean Software and were being used as a label for Ocean's coin-op ports. It came out on all the popular home computers of the day, the 8-bits, the C64, the Spectrum, the Amstrad CPC, possibly others like the MSX that we don't talk about, sorry French viewers, and also the 16-bits, the ST and the Amiga. Interesting to note though that although the box said Bad Dudes on it, the game itself only had DragonNinja on the title screen, and that's because the port was based on the Japanese version of the game, which has a slightly different ending, featuring the bad dudes chillaxing next to a statue of themselves rather than eating a burger with Ronnie. I believe Data East then took the Ocean / Imagine ports and released them in the States with a modified Bad Dudes title screen. Probably only the C64 and Amiga versions though, because the other computers never really sold that well over there. Don't know if they changed the ending to match the Bad Dudes version of the game though, so maybe somebody out there in internet land might be able to tell me if they did or not. Maybe, possibly, or not, who cares really. It's a long time ago, innit? Well, it looks like the truck is slowing down for boss time. Now, in the Japanese arcade version's ending, it says this guy here's name is Iron. In the Japanese NES, or should I say Famicom version of the game, his name is apparently Knee Nail. I think I'm just going to call him Clory Joe. Fucking have some, Clory Joe. How'd you like it? He's a bit of an arsehole, in all honesty. He can block your attacks. Also, when he's moving around sometime, his collision detection just fucking disappears, so you just have to wait until he's decided you can hit him again. Glad I got the nunchucks here, so I can stay out of relative harm and hit him from a distance. Ugh. Fucking have that, Clory Joe. There we go. He's dead. And I'm bad. I'm bad. You know it. I'm bad. Stage 2 clear. Go to the next stage. Go to next stage. Right. This time, we're fighting in a sewer, so not only do we have myriads of ninja to contend with, we had to contend with the smell of shit too. You can even see it, look, all those disturbing brown bits floating around in the sewer water. That's the first life gone. I blame Clory Joe. But we'll endure nevertheless. You see, the thing is with this game is it's quite easy to get through the majority of the stages, especially if you have the chucks. The only thing that really gives you hassle is the bosses, and most of the bosses aren't that hard either, so that means that this video could go on for a rather long time. Which isn't a problem in terms of YouTube's visibility algorithms, or my YouTube red earnings for that matter, but it's a problem for me right now because I have run out of most of the good things to say about Bad Dudes vs. DragonNinja. And that'll be a problem for you when you're all watching it, because you'll all end up switching off. So when you run out of good things to say, I guess it's time to move on to the bad. And I'm not talking about the bad in this game. Well, not yet anyway. But the bad in the franchise. But before I even move on to that, we are coming up to the third boss. Here he is. In the Japanese arcade version, he doesn't have a name. In the Famicom manual, he's called Hanzo. But I am going to call him Cloney Jim. Because that's what he does. He clones himself, and then we slap them all, and then we slap him a few times. And then he does it all over again. It's fun for all the family. Especially that uncle we all have that just loves punching clones. You know the one that I'm talking about. He comes to your Christmas dinner, and all he ever fucking does is ask you where your clones are. Then, over the rest of the afternoon, when you're trying to sit down and digest your turkey and watch Moonraker, he's there beating all your clones to a bloody pulp, while simultaneously gassing the entire house with Brussels sprout farts. I've got the distinct feeling he's going to clone one more time before I get the killing blow in. Yes, he is. When you're ready, lads. Ah, here we go. Hot boshings for you all. Is that it? Is that Cloney Jim Prime? That's not Cloney Jim Prime. Where are you? There you are. Ha ha. And the whole world has to answer right now just to tell us once again. Who's bad? I'm bad. Because I'm a bad dude. Stage three clear. Go to next stage. This time, we're going to the woods. Maybe we'll find a fucking bear! Just to answer that age-old question. We won't, because I've done this level before. There's no fucking bears in this game. Sorry. Right, let's get back on script and talk about the shitty side of bad dudes. Well, the shitty side of what's left of Data East. Let me give you a little background. Data East went bankrupt in 2003, I think it was, and many of its IP, including Bad Dudes, were bought by a mobile developer called Gmode. Now, they've barely done anything with it outside of releasing ports of old arcade games on the Wii and the Brazilian Zeebo console, but they were open to third parties developing new titles if they could pay for the licensing. Ninja on fire! Oh man, I completely forgot about that. As Dan McNinja once rightfully said, ninjas can't catch you if you're on fire, and I'm sure bad dudes can't either. Sorry, as I was saying before Mr. Burnpants turned up there, Gmo were open to third parties developing new games if they could pay for the licensing, and a few indie studios attempted to do just that by crowdfunding. First, there was Golgoth Studios, who in 2009 said they'd make a high-def Joe Mac Caveman Ninja game after they finished their HD remake of Toki. And that Toki remake had been in development for a good couple of years at that point, and in 2016 still hasn't appeared, despite the fact that they're still begging people for money to finish it via Patreon. So maybe we'll see that version of Joe Mac, say, in about 2025. And then, in 2012, was Pinstripe Games' Bad Dudes 2 Kickstarter, and oh man, where do I begin there? Well, I don't think I'm going to begin quite yet, because I want to finish this strapping young buck off first, and his name, in the Japanese arcade version and the Famicom manual, is Animal. And I want, and I need, and I love Animal. Named such, one can assume, because his design has been clearly ripped off from Animal of the Legion of Doom, or the Road Warriors, depending on the 1980s wrestling promotion of your choice. And he's got a freaking huge health bar. No, gotta admit, I was kind of hoping he'd keep trying to jump up to non-existent platforms. No such luck, so I'm going to attempt to try and entice him back over to the right, if I can. Come on. Walk over here. Walk over here. Come on. I'm honestly surprised he hasn't tried to get behind me to attack again, which is the usual standard for the boss AI in this. Come on. There he goes. He's done it. Let's try and keep him on the right-hand side. And here we go. Because the AI is that stupid, he should attempt to jump up to my level, despite the lack of platform, and we can finish him off. One more hit? I think so. There we go. I've run out of Michael Jackson references. So, we'll just leave him to saying he's bad. And, go next stage? Go next stage. Okay, now before that boss, I said I was going to talk about Pinstripe Games' ill-fated Bad Dudes 2 Kickstarter, didn't I? Well, you have waited, so you shall be rewarded. Right. Pinstripe were a couple of guys, maybe even just one, it's unclear, who previously kickstarted a very low-budget game called Jesh, which was never finished. Instead of finishing that game, in 2012, they realised that Gmode appeared to like to throw their licences around willy-nilly and decided to get in on that action by starting a Kickstarter for Bad Dudes 2, Return of DragonNinja. And they asked $80,000 to buy the license and develop the game. This campaign managed to get quite a bit of media coverage on gaming sites, such as your clickbait Tarkus and the like, and well, it was a clusterfuck from beginning to end. Firstly, the concept art that he had displayed initially was so un-Bad Dudes-like that you'd started to wonder if Pinstripe had ever bloody played the game to begin with. There was a prototype screenshot that had this hideous tiled background with sprites, which I swear were just edited rips from King of Fighters, which I'm pretty sure was more likely to have been a mock-up, because I find it hard to believe they'd done any type of hard graph before starting this Kickstarter. And then there was the storyline, taking cues from such legendary movies such as Indiana Jones 4. Oh god, the game was set 20... plus years after the first, where Johnny Whitepants and Bobby Pisspants are old and out of shape. And get this, one of them, I believe it was Bobby Pisspants, was fat and bald! So funny. Look, I know the story and the themes in the original here are corny, but do you know why it works? Because it's played straight. It's like the video game equivalent of a canon movie. And I'm not the only one that took umbrage here. Fans of Bad Dudes all came out of the woodwork to tell them how wrong they were, which led them to reveal better concept and sprite art, but at that point, it was too late. Nobody wanted this monster, and it didn't help that it had been revealed that they'd stopped developing their first game, Jesh, to concentrate on this one, which I'm sure you'll agree is real fucking professional. Needless to say, the Kickstarter did not meet its funding, reaching just over 5 grand of its 80 grand target. So, to this day, we've never seen a sequel to Bad Dudes vs. DragonNinja. Well, there's the pseudo sequel, Two Crude Dudes, which I have played on this very channel and has very similar gameplay, but not another one with the Pants Brothers fighting ninja. Oh, well, and I believe I am at the end of the train now and there's a boss coming. Here he is. This Kasari Gamma-wielding son of a bitch is called Akai Kage in the Japanese ending. In the Famicom manual, he's called, oh, get this, Killer Joe, which sounds more like a name that I'd come up with, in all honesty. I like to think that I'd come up with something a little bit more original, though. Let's see. Chainy Joe. Yes, Chainy Joe. Alas, I think Chainy Joe is going to kick my ass from here to next week, because unlike the other bosses in this game, he doesn't telegraph his attacks. Oh, for fuck's sake, there we go. I'm dead. I had no chance there, and where the bloody hell's he off to? Wherever. Oh well, that's it, I guess. Game over, innit? Wait for the countdown to finish. 2, 1, 0. Right, now let's put our name in. If only I hadn't needlessly wasted my lives, I could have defeated Chainy Joe. But alas, I will be forever remembered as Johnny Whitepants, the man who died to some chain-wielding idiot in a Ninja Turtle mask. Until next time, bye!